Good morning. Welcome to Lifetalks today. We're so glad you're all here. A little rainy. Did everybody get in okay? Did you figure out, is the detour still up? Do they still have the, no, it's all gone? Okay. They had it all blocked off this morning. We had a little accident over here on Cherry Vine. Well, good. Glad you all made it.
I just saw, they just posted, I don't know if you saw it or not, but they just posted all the pictures from this Spanish camp. Did you see that? Yeah, I think they posted like 40 pictures from Spanish camp. Great pictures. Awesome. So if you didn't get a chance to see any of the or to attend any of the services, go check it out on Facebook. It's really cool.
Do you know where it's located?
Ministerio Hispanico Ohio Distrito.
There you go. Just go find that.
Awesome. That's what.
Just out of know and you'll
I'm
find
not sure what I'm talking about, oh. But I say... Gloria a Dios, hermanos.
Yeah.
Y hermanas.
Hey, it's amazing. We had two get baptized
from Lifeway.
From Lifeway in New Carlisle. And yeah. So that's
amazing. You know, the interesting thing about it too is Maria Hernandez was one of them who got. We've got two Marias. It's Maria Hernandez, and watch this name, Maria Villarreal. That's her name, Maria Villarreal, and she anyway. But Maria Hernandez, her daughter, got the Holy Ghost at Spanish camp last year, and this is one of the reasons. Who all helped with the baptistry at New Carlisle? Can you raise your hand if you help with the baptistry? This is the one of the, huh? Yeah, this is one of the reasons why I'm so thankful for you guys and so thankful. And we sometimes, I want to highlight those kinds of things. And one of the reasons is because last year at Spanish camp, a lady from New Carlisle got the Holy Ghost and she got sick and died before she got a chance to get baptized. And her mom got baptized and got the Holy Ghost this year at Spanish camp, and she's been very faithful since her daughter died. And I'm like, God, don't ever let, please, Lord, don't ever. So that's I'm thankful. Thank you, Brother Rensel. Thank you, man, so much, Brother Prizer, for helping us get the baptistry, because I don't ever want a lack of availability or convenience to be something that we have to say, God, there's one of those situations that people talk about. You know, she got the Holy Ghost and she was waiting to get baptized and got sick immediately. And I'm like, God, you know, so.
He knows. Right. Well, let's dive in today. We're starting a little bit late, so let's get going. We talked last week about the last few weeks about what does mobilization mean. We've talked a lot about mobilization. We were back in the green room talking today about there's a lot of preaching. There's a lot of things that talk about the what and the why, but not a lot about the how. So today, we're going to dive in. I know even in, if you do any kind of multi-level marketing, the big thing is, what is your why? Why are you doing what you're doing? That's a big, big thing. Yeah. But the how is so important. And so today, we're going to talk about the how of mobilization. So we're going to dive in. I'm just going to let them take it away, and we'll all join the conversation. Remember to send your comments to lifetalks@thelifewaychurch.net.
I will try to remember to post what we call the map to multiplication. It's one of the things I know I've referenced some of the what we do, the Dillingham Group stuff. I've referenced that, but I will try to post the graphic called the map to multiplication in the Lifeway page. In fact, I was going to say you could post that, and then this is a good place to go if you're on the Lifeway family page or whatever. You could go there, and so she's going to check and see if she's got it right now. But the map to multiplication is a concept that we do a lot of. We teach pastors. We're currently coaching 30 ministers, over 20 pastors. And one of the things that we do with that we're talking about the Dillingham Group and the mobile, and also now we just developed the Mobilized Church Network. And so the Mobilized Church Network is a network of churches that are focused on being apostolic in message, mission, and methodology. So being apostolic in message, mission, and methodology, that's the Mobilized Church Network. And and so one of the things that we do is pastors come along and they're like, hey, we checked out your podcast. We've been, we heard from so-and-so, and how do we get in on this and whatever. So what we do is we start them off with what's called the multiplication assessment. And we and basically it's a survey. Brother Haltom helped us develop that survey. And so what we did was we take their responses to the questions of the survey, and then we do a survey review for them. It's about a 10-page review that we send back, and it helps them to see where their growth is coming from. Is their growth coming from, like, so a lot of questions about, you know, do you... you know, when you want to have church growth, do you say, well, let's have a revival? And so then you have a revival special, you know, a week or 2 weeks of services, and then tell people, hey, invite your friends. Hopefully they come. And there's nothing wrong with inviting your friends. You heard me say it last week, right? There's nothing wrong with inviting your friends. The point is, though, is that the latest data is suggesting that people are becoming decreasingly open to their first introduction to Jesus concepts as a church experience, right? To going to church, an invitation to a church service. And so, and the reason why that's, we really have to wrap our mind around that, because there are some people that just sort of, they've been geared in the world in which we live today. I think particularly the younger generation, and we mentioned last week, there may be some of us that are 50 and over. It may still be that there are some people in our generation that were raised with a biblical foundation, and they know what the Bible is, and they, you know, they say, yeah, I believe the Bible, you know. And so, you know, to sit down with somebody who's willing to say, yeah, I'd be willing to sit down for 10 or 12 weeks and do a Bible study with you, that's still a valid way to, you know, to build a relationship and connect with somebody and bring them to the truth of the gospel. Sure. But we're talking about people who don't know God. And there's an increasingly number of people who don't know God who have been, whether they say on the Gallup poll that they're a Christian, right? That's what we were talking about last week, that less than 50% of people who claim Christianity as their religion believe in the virgin birth, right? So that's almost like, that's like a litmus test, right? No, you're not Christian. If you don't believe in the virgin birth, you are not Christian, right? So this is something that this is just a simple litmus test that they ask the, you know, question. So some of it is belief and some of it is behavior. So, like, for example, Gallup does a belief and says, you know, to believe in virgin birth, do you believe that Jesus is coming back for his church, the, you know, quote-unquote rapture, etc.? And then others, questions are like, how often do you read your Bible? How often do you pray? How often do you attend a church service? And it kind of gauges sort of belief and behavior or doctrine and dedication, you know, kind of at the most, goodness, fundamental level, right? I mean, fundamental level. Do you read your Bible once a month? You know, that kind of deal. We'd be like, phew, boy. But I mean, they're using that as just sort of the most base level. Now, I think the reason why this is important as we talk about today, the sort of the how of mobilization, is I think that we've built the foundation pretty well of the why we need to be mobilized. And that foundation is that there's an increasing number of people in our world who are really pretty secular, regardless of what they say about what they, that they believe the Bible, regardless of whether or not they say, oh yeah, I was raised in church. And it's scary. The 25 and under crowd who say they, you know, I'm not talking about an apostolic church. I'm talking about the broadest spectrum of Christianity that basically say, yeah, I go to church. I believe in God, you know, blah, blah, blah. But they have a predominantly secular worldview. Yeah. And I think that's one of the things that, you know, that's the reason why when we talk about, you know, public education and those kinds of things, it's not that we're like, you know, like all anti-public education or whatever. We're not. But what we are is to say, folks, that has become sort of a training ground for secular humanism, right? Yeah. And so if you know, and I know not everybody can afford a Christian school. I know not everybody can, you know, they can make that happen, or maybe they don't have the conviction for that. But if you better watch out and know that your children are being trained to be secular humanists.
Absolutely. Ask a lot of questions to your kids. What are they learning? What did the day hold? And do triple training biblically.
That's true.
Work overtime.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, and so, you know, we're just living in a world right now, and it's like, you know, there was a day back in the day, right? There was a day when, for the most part, you go to school and you learn, you know, reading, writing, and arithmetic, and you know, whatever. But now there's just so much that's now. But that's not our topic today. The point is that what that's producing is it's producing a generation. It's producing people who do not see Christianity as relevant.
Yeah.
Okay. They just don't see Christianity as relevant. And I think that this is so stinking important as we think about doing the mission, right? Once we just sort of say to ourselves, we're called to reach the world, doggone it. We're called to reach the world, right? I mean, we can't just say, oh, let's just build a big, you know, planetarium and just live inside of it and, you know, until the rapture. We're called to reach the world. So I think that what we need to do is we need to be able to look at it and say, okay, well then, how do you... So here's the point. It's not that the power of God is ineffective. It's not that the power of God is not able to reach down and touch their lives and draw and touch them in deep places. It's not that they're not open to it. In fact, I would say probably that this generation is probably the most open to a Pentecostal style experience than any generation that's come in the last 100 years in the United States.
Yeah, they're so experiential.
But right. Yeah. And so I think that in some ways, while we talk about that people are, you know, maybe turned off to saying, you know, yeah, good for you, that's your truth, that's not my truth, or, you know, I know. You know, but what's relevant in 2022 about a book that was written 2,000 years ago? I mean, come on, you know. And so I think that what we need to understand is that, yes, the power of God, the experience of the Holy Ghost, the moving of God's Spirit, speaking in tongues, the gifts of the Spirit, miracles, signs, and wonders, these things I believe that this generation are open to. But what we're going to have to really make our mind up about is the fact that we will, if the statistics are accurate, and there's no reason to believe they're not, okay, it's very credible sources, Pew Research Council, Lifeway Research Group, Barna, okay, I mean, three of the most reputable research organizations in the world are saying that about 40% of people are open to a church invitation as their first introduction to the things of God, while the same test group, 80% are open to a spiritual conversation with someone that they trust about how you developed your spiritual identity, your worldview, how Jesus made a difference in your life. I mean, what that means is that we may misread the openness of our world if all we're doing is saying, hey, you ought to come to church with me sometime.
Yes.
It will affect our faith and our view of the power of the gospel when you look at somebody and say, hey man, you ought to come to church with me sometime. Like, nah, I don't do the church thing, man. right? And you're like, well, they must not want Jesus, so they're closed off. And I've had people even say to me, Pastor, people just don't want Jesus anymore. And I'm like, yeah, they do. Yes, they do. It's just that your method from 40 years ago isn't working today, right? And it works on 40% of the people. But what we've got to come to the conclusion of is this, but of that same 60%, okay, of the 60% that aren't open to an invitation to a church service, of that 60%, 40% of them are open. 4 out of 6, 2/3 of the people who are not open to a church invitation, and yet 2/3 of them are open to you sitting down with them over coffee and saying, let me tell you how Jesus changed my life.
You know what I think is so amazing is the money, the time that these churches have invested on the experience. Dude. And the making your visitors feel welcome. And I mean,
millions.
Millions of hours and dollars in this, and that's not even what's really reaching our world. It's not going to make them want to come anymore.
And if all those people don't believe in the virgin birth, they're not helping them anyway.
Yeah. I don't believe Jesus was virgin born, but they got great music.
And I get a free coffee. So, I mean, yeah, isn't that...
But the thing about it is, here's the deal, and I'm gonna hit two things. I think that's an excellent observation. Sister D.
Thanks.
Yeah, it's an excellent observation. It's an excellent observation because here's the deal. Because that's what a lot of churches are staking their missional impulse on.
Because they know that people are not comfortable coming. They know that. They're aware of that.
You know.
I mean, they know. But so this is how we're going to do it.
And that's why there's such a big movement toward online church. Not that some of those things are not helpful or beneficial, but it's like, okay, now we have to figure out how to produce an experience when they're not in the doors, but through the institution.
So that's the thing. So you see, as you think about this and it just rolls over and over and over, what happens is you look at some of these things and like just like he said, so the deal is like, oh man. Well, you know, we had COVID, and then we've got, you know, a bunch of people that are like, they don't want to come to church. So how can we do a great ad campaign on Facebook and bring a video to them? I say it like this. Any way that you want to try to reach people and bring the hope of the gospel to them, I'm not going to get hacked off at you. But I am going to say, why is it that our first impulse is, what can the institution do?
Yeah.
I mean, do you want to talk to that at all? I mean, the difference between what can the institution do versus the organic church, that Jesus had in the first century.
Yeah, well, some of this goes back to the Industrial Revolution, when you started having, and not to get too nerdy here, but thinking about the assembly line. Yep. How do we systematize work so that we reduce error, increase quality, and get the max output out of people?
Eli Whitney's interchangeable worship.
Exactly. And so that kind of thinking has made its way into the church. Let's break it down and figure out what kind of customer are we serving and how do we systematize the experience and plug people in like a cog in the wheel so that we can maximize the output of our experience. And so when you look at this idea of what can the institution do, it's based on the belief that you can try to optimize. Number one, it's based on the belief that what we're providing is a product.
That's good.
And it's based on the belief that we can optimize that product through human effort.
Wow.
But Jesus turns the table and says, actually, what I've done is I've put my spirit in the hearts of individual believers, and the output of the whole, following the spirit, operating according to the spirit, living out the values of Jesus, that's actually optimization.
So it's interesting because if you think that you're product is an experience with God, then the institution is going to do that way better. It's like, the institution is going to do that way better than the organic church. Yeah. But if you believe that what Jesus came to offer was an invitation to covenant, an invitation to covenant can happen in your living room. An invitation to covenant can happen in your sitting at a coffee shop. There's no way that you can reproduce the worship experience at home or at a coffee shop. So if we think that the product that we're offering that's going to reach people is a worship experience or even an experience with Jesus, if we think that that's the product, then we say, well, the product is best produced here. That doesn't devalue what we do here.
Right.
It just has to change our mindset that says when we come here and what we come here for is not to produce a product of a worship experience, but to come as the fellowship of believers and the body of Christ together, lifting up the King of Kings and enjoining ourselves with one another, right? Do people who don't know God come to this place and feel and experience something? Absolutely they do. There is an experience, right, in God. But what we're saying is that what we're offering the world, what Jesus offered, I mean, we don't have anything to offer the world, which is a whole different side wing of the conversation. We don't have anything to offer. The only thing we have to offer is the gospel, an invitation to covenant. That's all we have to offer. We don't have anything to offer. Why? Because the best of our efforts will not save a soul. We don't have anything to offer. So when we say, well, our church has... See, do you see why and people don't like it. They get angry at me when I make these kind of statements. I make statements like, nobody's impressed with your coffee shop. And they get mad at me when I make these kind of statements. They really do. Because I've had three prophecies in the last 4 months that says God is going to give you boldness to withstand the criticism. I'm like, I didn't even know they're criticizing me.
God has blinded your eyes.
You know what I'm saying? I'm like, wait a minute. Everybody loves me. What is that like?
Apparently, you already have that boldness.
Yeah. I'm like,
Brother Ellis came and prayed that boldness on you many years ago. I remember that service. Like,
well, they may criticize me, but they still love me. What is that on the Enneagram thing?
You're going to ask that. We'll have to ask Kaylin.
That's like an Enneagram thing. Like, oh, that's a three. Or, you know what? Yeah. I don't even know what those things mean, but people are like, oh, that is definitely a three. It's like, It's like, you may criticize me, but you love me. You know, people like you are like.
Yeah, rare breeds.
Yeah. So here's the thing that I think is so important as we talk about this. And when I make these statements, and I'm not trying to be harsh. I'm not trying to be a contrarian, right? I don't get joy out of being, you know, sort of like the burr in the saddle, you know, type deal. But what I do want people to sort of come to the conclusion of is to say that there's nothing wrong. And this is another hard thing for us in a truth-oriented church is to say, well, then if the coffee shop, then bless God, then we just need to tear it out, the coffee shop. We just need to, you know. The mindset is, no, it's not an either-or deal. It's a both-and thing. But the point is this, okay? None of that could be the missional methodology. So how are you going to reach the world? We're going to have the coolest church in town. And the lost are going like, I'm not impressed. Mm-hmm. Not that cool. No, for real. The lost are saying, I'm not impressed. And you're like, well, some churches are growing. Yeah, exactly. The churches that are appealing to cultural Christians. The churches that are going, man, your church is way cooler than the church I came from.
Yeah.
That's what cultural Christians say. But the lost, I'm talking about really, truly, honestly lost people, they're like, kind of cool, you got a coffee shop. We can go to Starbucks.
Yeah, the concert I went to last week was way better than this.
Right. Way cooler, So I think that what we have to come to the conclusion of, so let's dive into sort of the how.
Before you do, I'm gonna ask you a question. Yeah. Do you believe that the church worship experience in feeling the Spirit of God once a week is a product, is what is causing the repentance cycle of how so many people live in their walk with God, especially new believers?
100%. 100%, because here's why. Because, well, I don't want to get too deep in this, but yeah, I think that what happens is people come to church on Sunday, and then they go through the week, and it's like, you know, three quarters of a tank, half a tank, quarter of a tank, come to church, get a fill up. Yeah, absolutely. You know, and the world in which we're facing. I mean, we had a podcast here recently where basically we said that the attractional model system, the attractional model church, we said it is absolutely and the discipleship. See, because here's the deal. Your discipleship paradigm will match your foundational structure. So if you're what you just said, you said, okay, we're joking with Eli Whitney worship, you know, interchangeable parts and the Industrial Revolution and all that happened from that. You know, as you were talking about that, we got to stop and think. If the mindset is, how can we do it better? How can we do it more efficiently? And the idea is, well, a factory can produce products faster, more efficiently, and with less errors than a mom and pop shop. You could have a blacksmith who put a blacksmith out of, you know, business. Before Henry Ford put a blacksmith out of business, people that were mass producing horseshoes put blacksmiths out of business. Yeah. And so what we got to do is we got to look at this and we've got to say, I don't want to get really deeply philosophical, but I believe these are the kinds of things that help to change our paradigm. but the idea was, who put the gun maker out of business? Like the gunsmith, right? The local, the dude that's got like a gun shop and he's got a gunsmith. That was Eli Whitney's, right? Interchangeable parts was like with guns, so that people could, you know, if something went bad, the hammer broke, they could switch out a hammer, whatever. But eventually what happened was factories that could mass produce cheaper and as high a quality put the gunsmith out of business. So the mindset was over time was the church could way better reach the world than individuals and families and small groups of people. If we could do this bigger and better, then we'll reach more people because they'll be more impressed. And what's happening is that there's an anti-institutional mindset that's gripping our world today. Think about this for a moment. People are like, big pharma? Hello? Right? Why are people scared of big pharma? Big pharma, because you know what they want to do? They just want to sell their next product. May cause ruptures in the heart, brain bleeds, and death.
For a sinus infection.
Yeah, psoriasis. Yeah. Rim dizzy or whatever it was called. You know, whatever. And so big pharma, big government, big, you know, whatever. Big tech, right? And, you know, so on and so forth. What is it? It's the bigger the institution, the more possibility that they're in it for themselves and they've got the power to steamroll you. And so there's a whole generation that's come along saying, you know what? Bigger and better and more powerful, more profound, and a more awesome machine isn't necessarily going to reach them. But I think the thing that you're saying is, and it doesn't say that there's anything wrong with this. It's just simply saying their first connection is going to have to be you. They're not going to walk. They're not going to walk into a. You know, in 1990, somebody could walk into a 2,500 seat auditorium and say, "Dude, this place must be better than my church," because my church only seats 250, right? And but that's just not the mindset anymore. And but here's the deal. But in that institutional church mindset, the Industrial Revolution church mindset, discipleship was built around training people and engaging people and involving them in the process so that the machine could be bigger and better and more efficient and more attractive, and people walk in and go, wow.
Yeah.
But I'm going to tell you something right now. In some way, Jesus may be looking and saying, I'm not impressed with your wow. I'm supposed to be the wow. Jesus is supposed to be the wow. We ought to get on our faces and we ought to repent that we've tried to take a product to replace Jesus. People are like, well, I haven't taken a product to replace Jesus. I ask people all the time. I'm like, you haven't? Then let me ask you a question. Are you a better salesman for your church or for your Savior? When you talk to people about God, do you look at them and go, dude, you ought to come to my church. You'd love my church. Oh, my word, we've got blah, 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 whatever. Is that the easier conversation? Or do you have an easier conversation saying, dude, you would love my Savior? I'm going to tell you something. Let me just tell you what he did for me. People are like, now I know why people don't like you.
Why is it so hard? Why is it so hard to say?
Oh, that's... Oh, man.
Why is it easier to invite to church when churches are life because of
people
Jesus?
Respond.
Respond. Why is it so hard? Why is it easier to say, would you come to church with me, than say, you know what, this is what Jesus did for me and he can do it for you?
I've got a list of five things I can say, but I want to talk. I've talked.
Send it. Lifetalks.
I've talked at people today a lot, and I want to talk with them. That's why we do Lifetalks. But, I mean, there's a list of, yeah.
I'm going to stop there.
You guys talk. I'm done.
Well, it's interesting. Isn't that sort of what the Pharisees did? They were more interested in preserving their temple than they were being open to what the Messiah might come and do in their lives. One of the Bible actually says why they sought to kill Jesus in one particular passage of Scripture, and it says because they were afraid that they would come and take their temple away.
Yeah, he said 3 days I'll destroy the temple, and they're like, oh, we got to kill him.
Got to get rid of him, because that's what we value. They didn't value Jesus; they valued the temple. They valued the institution of the law. Because they were able to operate inside of their system better than everybody else on the surface.
See, you can be carnal and fit into an institutional church system.
You can't keep dropping these and then just putting your mic down. You have to keep talking.
No, for real, you can be carnal and you can be carnal and... You can be looking at porn and sing on the platform. But it's hard to be looking at porn and pray. It's hard to be carnal and put your life on the altar. It's hard to be carnal and get up on that altar and say, God, let me die. The flesh says, let me live. The flesh resists dying. And so when you have a church that resists consecration and resists holiness and resists dying, it is a fleshly church. And you say, well, how do we get a fleshly church? Because we do it fleshly. We try to impress people with the stinking show.
And that's how the Pharisees maintained their elite status.
Carnal.
That's right.
That's right. flesh dies hard. I was talking to Pastor Aaron Bounds this morning, and I don't know what time his service starts. I don't want him to blow. His message today is going to be when flesh dies, earthquakes happen. And his message today is that when Jesus died on the cross, there was an earthquake, and the graves opened up, and so you know he's preaching today that you want a shift in the foundation. Flesh has to die. And I think this is something we just got to wrap our brain around and say, you know, you can create an environment where a person's gifting, because if you got an institutional church and your machine is the thing that you think is going to be the attraction and going to reach people, then what happens is the most important people in that environment are people that are the most gifted and the most talented. So you put up with people who are fleshly, and you put up with people that are carnal because you need their gift. But in a church that is, you know, but in a church that is biblical and apostolic, and it's spirit, and it's Jesus is the centerpiece of all of this. You don't get Jesus unless you deny yourself and pick up your cross. You don't get Jesus till you die. God's a wise investor. He's not going to send resurrection power to stuff that isn't dead.
Okay, couple comments. An area, the reason why it's so much easier just to invite somebody to church, which, I mean, he just hit it. But it's an area of unbelief that Jesus will follow through with your claims. So it's easier just to say, come to church, than this is what Jesus will do for you, because you've got unbelief in your heart, not believing he'll really do it. Here's another one.
Our fruit comes back to what we believe.
100%. Absolutely. Because it's hard to deal with people's personal problems. It's easier to drop them off at the altar.
Yes.
And expect God to transform them.
Yes. Yes.
It's easier to appeal to their eyes and ears. Yes. Than to turn on someone's faith.
Yes.
By the way, unbelief is what perpetuates the institutional thinking.
Yes.
Jesus rebuked the Pharisees not just because of their legalism, but because of their unbelief.
Yes.
If they had believed in God, they would have believed in Jesus more than their institution.
They said, we have Abraham as our father. And Jesus said, you're not of your father Abraham, because if you were, you'd do the works of Abraham. He had never even seen the land, and he believed and went. You've seen miracles and still don't believe. Don't tell me that you're Abraham's kids. You are of your father, the devil. Like, you're like, man, Pastor, you're really being hard today. I'm like, oh, I still haven't entered into Jesus' realm of being hard. I still haven't told Ben.
Should I move this before you turn the table over?
I thought it was going to go flying down there. Here's one. I think one of the reasons we invite people to church rather than a discipleship conversation about Jesus is because we tell ourselves, once we invite someone, our job is over. Our human nature does everything it can to take the easy way.
Yep.
Telling someone about Jesus truly requires our time and effort outside of the institution.
That's so good.
It's work.
It's hard work. So another thing is, and this is another, so another piece of the how. We might as well do some how. We might as well do some how today. So, I think one of the reasons why maybe we invite people to church is because one of the questions that I ask pastors is, I ask them this question. I say, can I ask you a question? Yes. Do you have the depth of relationship with a person to have a spiritual conversation? Or is your depth of relationship with them only deep enough to give them a invitation to church? I think that one of the things that we need to really think about is that to have the kind of conversations that are transformational conversations to really be able to have like a conversation with somebody to actually introduce them to the transformational places in your life. And the thing about it is, folks, look, don't go back and go, well, when Jesus saved me, I was this and he did all these things. No, there ought to be somewhere that Jesus transformed you 6 months ago. There ought to be places in your life that he's still transforming, like places where, you know, I went through, like there need to be places where you say, you know, I went through this. And by the way, talking about transformation is, you know, I'm just going to use this as an example, but let's just say, for example, Sister Lorman. Like Sister Lorman could say, you know, Jesus showed me, my husband was overseas in the military for a year, right? And in that year's time, Jesus had to be my blah, blah, blah. Jesus had to be my blah, blah, blah. And there may be places where you could point at and go, you know, when Jimmy was home, Jimmy provided that. But Jimmy was overseas, and so Jesus had to take that place. And I realized, you know, that Jimmy's awesome, and I love him, but he's not nearly as good as Jesus, right? And so I'm not talking about transformation like saying, you know, 6 months ago I was smoking weed, but Jesus, you know, I mean, I know those are the kinds of things that, and I mean, if 6 months ago you were smoking weed and Jesus took it away from you and that's your testimony today, I'm really cool with that.
Yeah, listen to this. This says, I think that sometimes we think if we can just get them to church and then see, they can see how awesome God is. I didn't think about what God has done in my life could be enough.
Actually, that's a more awesome, how awesome God is better seen in you than he's seen here.
And you who sent that in have an amazing testimony of how God is seeing you through your situation right now. Do you realize how many people you could minister to right now that are going through things and you can say, I know how difficult it is because I'm dealing with it, but yet God is walking right beside me? What an incredible, they're going to feel more of Jesus in that than coming and hearing the song we're going to sing today.
And this is why, you know, one of the things that is so important about ongoing discipleship and seeing ourselves as though Jesus and realizing Jesus is still changing what we care about is that we have to have ongoing testimonies of how Jesus is doing that. I think a lot of times when I was growing up, I would always default to things when I was giving someone a testimony that happened years ago. And I still find myself doing that. But as disciples, we ought to have testimonies constantly of how Jesus is constantly changing our value system.
Man, that is so good. That's so good.
Because then the testimonies, they're not small. Weekly, God is giving you new testimonies. God is reviving you. He's restoring you.
Which means you have to walk in it, and it can't be just because when you're not walking in it, then it's easy to say, hey, why don't you come to church with me?
Because a lot of times that indicts us when we say, I don't really have that big of a testimony. Well, why not? What's Jesus done for you lately? Right. What's he doing in you this week? What has Jesus been speaking? This is one of the questions you ask. What is Jesus speaking to you about through his word?
And that's one of the things, one of the questions, and that's one of our X group questions. The first X group question is, since our last meeting, what has he been speaking to you about from his word or spirit? What's he been dealing with? What's he been talking to you about? And the reason why that's important is because in an X group context, you say, what is an X group again? An X group is when you have found at least two disciplable people and you start meeting with them either weekly or biweekly to just sit down and to intensify their discipleship and the transformation that's in their life. So when you look at a person and say, so what is the Spirit of God, what is the Word of God been pressing in on in your life? Where, like, you know, and I change it up the way I ask the question. Like, I'll ask the question and say, what are some places that Jesus has been demanding lordship over idols? right? Tell me in the last week or two how Jesus has been saying, I want to be Lord over that. Tell me what that is and tell me how Jesus has been doing that in your life. And I'm going to tell you something crazy. You talk to people who this is the way that they were introduced to a relationship with Jesus, and they absolutely will sit there and look at you and say, you know, and they will bring up stuff that you're like, whoo. I mean, this is real, man. This is real. But then they turn around and they tell their coworkers and their friends and their neighbors, and they go, dude, I'm going to tell you something right now. Man, I had this idol in my life, and Jesus has been saying to me, like, if I'm the resurrected king of the universe, then why do you let that sit on your throne? Yeah. And this is the way they talk, right? But like I'm talking about people that have been in church for like 2 months. And they're like, man, Jesus has been telling me that he's ticked off that I got this sitting on the throne and he wants to be sitting on the throne. And so, right, and they're telling friends and family and whatever, and they're like, what does it mean sitting on the throne of your life? What are you talking about? Yeah. And they're able to communicate that and say, well, man, this thing, whatever sits on your throne is your king. And whatever's your king is sovereign in your life and it rules. And so this addiction or this way of talking or this way of living or this trusting money was sitting on the throne of my heart. And it was, right?
I had so one thing to just say to that, and I'll give you a personal example. But if you look in the Old Testament at times where the prophets and the people of God would destroy idols, a lot of times that story was coupled with a miraculous demonstration. Mm-hmm. So Elijah calling fire from heaven, that wasn't a magic trick. Right. That was God showing, no, actually, I'm the one with power. Baal has no power, and I'm going to prove it to you.
Yeah. Dagon.
Dagon. And so you could go through, and that's where a lot of times our testimonies come from. And so I had a recent example where I felt where God challenged me to give an offering that was more than I was comfortable affording at the time. And what I came to the conclusion of was that God was moving on me to help me destroy this thinking that money provides my security.
So you're saying God was what I'm hearing you say, I'm not going to tell you what you're saying. What I'm here, which is, by the way, a great skill in spiritual conversations, right? What I'm hearing you say is you're saying that Jesus said no man can serve God or mammon, right? That's the scripture that connects to that. So Jesus was unseating the security of mammon in your life?
Yes. Wow. Hands down. And then 2 weeks later, what happened was God provided for me financially, and that total amount was 5 times what I gave.
Wow, that's amazing. And I think there's an example, though. See, there's an example where you say, you know, I had this, I had this idol sitting in my life. I still had a place in me where mammon, you know, which is the mammon is actually the word that associates with the security that comes from financial stability, right? And so God comes along and says, you know, look, I don't mind you having money. Yeah. It's just your security better not come from it, because I'm God, right? Which goes back to my sermon last Sunday. Last Sunday, if you remember, I preached God is the source, right? So in the beginning, God said, I make everything, I provide everything, and then it's there. So I am the provider, you're the dependent. And God said, that's the relationship that you are healthy in, and that's the relationship that you grow in.
The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof.
Right. And so what is our human nature? Our human nature is to self-sufficiency. So what do we have to do? We don't just simply have to fight against our inclination of independence from God. We have to fight our inclination to self-sufficiency. And so a person could be in church for 15 or 20 years and be able to acknowledge their dependence on God, but still live in a state of self-sufficiency.
And see, this is why a lot of times we feel like we don't have any testimonies.
See, that's what I'm saying. Because it's like, well, that's not a drug. I heard somebody get up and talk about they had, you know, tracks all down their arm and, you know, blah, blah, blah. And it's like, that's a testimony. Sure, it's a testimony. But that's a huge testimony, too. And that's a testimony from somebody who gets up and preaches. And I could share testimonies. My wife could share testimonies. I'm not talking about testimonies from 6 years ago. I'm talking about testimonies from 6 weeks ago.
Yeah.
Those things right there, I believe, demonstrate to people the power of God better than we could ever produce a worship environment.
Oh, man. We sing how great is our God, but let me show you how great, in fact, he is.
See, and I'm going to tell you something. I'll tell you something pretty cool. Some cultures that I've been talking to, what they'll do is they'll sing a worship song, and they'll sing how great is our God, or they'll sing some worship song about it or whatever. And instead of doing a worship set, instead of just going from song to song to song and then offering announcements and then song and then preaching, what they'll do is they'll insert a video testimony. They'll insert somebody who gets up and says, hey, you know, they'll keep the music playing, whatever, and say, you know what, 6 months ago I was dealing with depression and anxiety, but I began to realize that it came from my lack of trust. I don't have... A clinical depression. It's just situational, and the world started feeling like a scary place to me, and it caused me to realize, and I'm talking about a saint of God that's been in church for 30 years.
So what you're saying is they have to be not only be a disciple where Jesus is changing what they care about, but they also have to be
vulnerable. Yeah.
And don't be afraid to put it out. Who cares if you've been in church? How long have you been in church? A long time.
His whole life.
But he's not afraid to sit up here and say, I had to have a place in me where Jesus changed what I cared about. And he's not afraid to say that. So we can't be afraid to go out and say, you know what? I'm not perfect, and be vulnerable.
Yeah.
I didn't even think about, you know, what's cool about our culture is there was zero nervousness about sharing that.
Right. See, and I think, and that's the thing, where you take a woman who's in this setting almost 60 years old, who gets up and says, you know, I've been in church, and I would be the first one to take my Bible and say God is in control. I'd be the first one to say, but in my subconscious thinking, I started thinking, actually, this is in control and that's in control, and you know, it was COVID, now it's monkeypox, and then it's $5 a gallon gas, and now it's the groceries are through the roof, and da da da, and all of that stuff was mounding up in my mind to think that my life is at the mercy of fate. And somebody said to me, is the anxiety that you're experiencing, this woman, is the anxiety that you're experiencing a lack of confidence that God is in control, and in the end, his will be done, and God wants to demonstrate his ability to take care of you in the midst of all of this. This stuff isn't in control of you. It's just a setup for God to be able to demonstrate his sovereignty in your life. And this woman said, I got convicted because I was putting confidence in all of these things that they were in control of my life. And I repented. And as I repented and as I began to study and read about God being in control of my life, all of a sudden the anxiety and fear started lifting off of me. And I began to realize, dude, we got to get away from this boutique idea that everybody's got anxiety. Instead of normalizing it, let's go back to what it is that God wants. And man, she got up and shared this testimony.
That's amazing. And so when God starts changing you, because we are all disciples, and when God starts changing you and doing things, start looking for somebody. God's going to bring somebody across your path that needs to hear it. So start figuring out, who is it, and let me share that with them instead of first inviting them to church. And then invite them to church, because we all want to meet them and see what God's doing in their life.
And
right?
They still need to come and feel.
Yes.
Queen of Sheba came and saw Solomon's temple and saw it and said, oh my word, the half had only been told me.
Right.
So yeah, it's going to be cool. What we got to understand is it's not either or. We got to get out of the either or mindset.
Absolutely.
We can't say it's either this or that.
Yep.
Okay. That's like this while you were talking, and I just want to say this, and that's like saying, you know, family is dysfunctional in 2022. Family is dysfunctional. So we all need to just live as separate entities and an island and blah, 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 blah. And God's like, no, you were created for community. And so the thing about it is, here's the deal. When we start talking about institutionalism, when we start talking about the institutional church and whatever, we need to say, you know, you don't say, well, down with the church. See, that's the stupid pendulum swing that people sometimes do, that their mentality is, well, then what good is the church then? Let's just go out and reach the world. And it's like, well, no, forsake not the assembling yourselves together. What we have to do is we have to rediscover that what healthy family is, right? Don't go off and say, well, then let's just create, you know, let's just turn Lifeway into, you know, 50 small groups and just do home church. And God's like, oh, for crying out loud.
It's almost like a healthy diet, right? If all you'd ever do is focus on steak and eat steak, you're not going to be healthy.
Right.
Keep the steak,
right,
but add the veggies.
There you go. See, that's the thing. So we need to look at it and say, there's a reason why we come together, and God's great and glorious when we show up, and we ought to praise him and magnify him. And you know what? And it's not like saying, you know, well, we shouldn't sing and worship and do all these. Yeah. Just understand that it's because he's worth it. Don't do that as, man, if we do this good enough, then all of our guests may come back next week. No, get up here and sing and worship and praise God and dance across the platform and fall off the, well, no, don't do that. Just fall off the stage. But worship and praise God and magnify God and sing and glorify God and have church and have throw down church and let, you know, and preaching and amen and hoot and holler and all of those things, because he's good and he's worthy and he's great and he's sovereign, and do all that to the glory and renown of our great God. And but don't make it our missional methodology.
Wow, power packed today. I don't know about you, but we got to go find somebody. Go find somebody to share your story with. Okay, but right now it's time to stop, and you have time for a donut. You have time at our amazing coffee shop. Please don't forget your children. If they're in Sunday school, the teachers would love for you to come pick your children up, and we'll see you back in here at 11.
We do great coffee because he's a great God.